So let's take a look at one more transistor tester. After finishing the previous video, I realized I actually have two donated ones. So again, big thanks for the donation, and now let's take a look at this one and compare it with the previous one. I decided to compare them before I forget and everybody forgets how the previous one performed. And this one is a kit with some box for it which you can assemble yourself. The way it's testing components or transistors seems to be very similar. I put the same type of transistor into both, and this one seems to test a bit faster. And as you can see, this one has a very dim display in comparison to this one. So let's try to use a dimmer light and one more test. And again, this one is actually faster, but this one actually brings more information on the transistor. This one only says the gain and the forward voltage base to emitter. Doesn't even say it's base to emitter, it says just forward voltage, like if it was a diode. This one brings more information, it says the testing current, the collector current used during the test, and the leakage currents. This one doesn't say it. Putting the same resistor in both. 10 kilo ohms, both of them are very close. Low resistance 3.3 ohm resistor, and 0.1 ohm is going to be very inaccurate, of course. One actually measures way higher, one way lower. Now let's compare some fluorescent inductor readings. This is again very similar and very close. A germanium transistor. This shows the leakage current and the test current. This one can also identify a germanium transistor, low base to emitter voltage drop, and this is its gain, but definitely less information, no leakage current, no test current. It can also identify a triac, but it doesn't show its voltage drop. This one shows the voltage drop for a triac. And of course the same applies to thyristors, and it's using about 6 or 7 milliamps for the gate, and if the gate doesn't trigger at this current, it will not identify a thyristor or triac. Just like this one might identify a thyristor as a transistor with a zero gain. And this one actually identifies an IGBT transistor as a MOSFET. This one identifies the IGBT transistor properly. But only if the gate threshold is less than 5 volts. This IGBT probably has a higher gate threshold voltage than 5 volts. And this tester only has 5 volts for the test, and this one identifies just as a diode. And of course the other one can't do any better, having just 5 volts for the test. Both of them can measure capacitors, the capacitance including the ESR and the voltage loss, probably the dissipation factor of it. And the other one shows roughly the same. And the ESR reading is very close to this ESR meter. And for low inductances, this one again seems to have 0.01 mHg resolution. This is a 47 microhenry inductor, or 0.047 mHg. And it again shows its DC resistance. This one with the same inductor. But I don't want this to be a long video, so let's just quickly compare it and talk about the differences. This one has a black and white reflective display. It has a backlight, but it's very readable, even without the backlight. Being a reflective display, you can read it in a very bright light. This one is a full color display, with a dim backlight, and it's not readable in a bright light. And there is no reason to use a color display. Each pixel is just in two states. And this one is much simpler. It doesn't have the rotary encoder. It has just a button to turn it on. So it doesn't have any menu and special functions like a voltmeter, frequency meter, signal generator and pulse width modulation generator. And no settings. They both have the same socket, but a different pin configuration on them. It's a 14-pin socket, 7 plus 7, and the configuration of the terminals here is 1-1-1-2-3-3-3, and here it's 1-2-3-1-1-1-1. And of course this configuration seems way more convenient to me because you can insert components with 3 pins of various pin spacing. This one for example, but this one, this big transistor, can go in like this. And I could even put a bigger transistor than this in it. Here, here and here. In this one it's 1-2-3-1-1-1-1, so it's good for this size of transistors, but how do I insert this? It just doesn't work. It'll have to somehow bend it and botch it and get it in like this, for example. That's horrible, that's extremely inconvenient. I was actually testing this transistor in it like this, bending the penis end. This is a stupid layout. This definitely should also have been 1112333 or something like this. So let's sum quickly the differences up. This one has a better readable display, it's simpler to use and it works faster, but it shows less information, has less functions, and the terminal configuration of this socket is stupid. This one has the better configuration of the socket, it has more functions, it shows more information, but it's working slower, it might be a bit complex and the display is dim. But I would probably still prefer this one, especially because of the better socket and more information on the transistor. Both of them are of course able to test LEDs. And this one has a slight bug in it. This piece of line should be actually here, not here, when testing an inductor between 1 and 3. Somebody probably missed it. And it's again measuring capacitors from about 20 or 25 picofarads, but now let's take a look at the other side of it. This one is much simpler than the other one. It has the same chip, ATmega328P, but in this case it's an SMD version. It again has an 8 MHz crystal with its two capacitors, some capacitors, resistors, diodes, 431 voltage reference, three transistors here, similar to the other one, some capacitors, resistors, and a 78L05 voltage regulator of 5 volts. And these measuring resistors again, 470 kilo-ohms and 680 ohms for each terminal. And this voltage regulator is an old school one. It draws about 5 milliamps for its own operation and its minimum voltage drop is about 2 volts, so it can work down to 7 volts on this battery. Modern regulators are probably much better, they have just a couple microamps own consumption and the minimum voltage drop can be a couple hundred millivolts only, so it can work down to about 5.2 volts, let's say, on the battery. The software is probably similar, but this one seems to be less intelligent, it cannot tell IGBT from MOSFETs and it's showing less information, but both of them are probably using some clone of the software made by the two German guys, Markus and Karl Heinz. On the internet you can buy like crazy amount of versions of these testers. The German guys made it as an open source and Chinese makers took the schematics and software and started making it as kits. The same happened to my frequency meter. I developed it, I put the schematic and program on my website and now the Chinese guys are selling it as kits. Now let's try to assemble the housing. It's much better to have it in some box to protect it from damage, especially this display cable could be damaged very easily, it's sticking out from it, and I also have to say that it's not a good idea to run it like this, just a bare board, because if you lay it on something conductive, you can short it out and destroy it or damage it, and also just touching it with your fingers can actually skew the measurement. Here is the box. It seems to be made of plexiglass with some paper on it. This will look nice. But it's of course a bit laborious to remove the paper from it. It probably says acrylic. This paper is annoying. And it has 8 screws for it. 4 probably go into the holes of the board and into this. And the other 4 actually mounted the top of it on it. Let's just randomly assemble it, trial and error. This, this. Then probably the board and the nuts on it. Well, this thing is turning into an ASMR channel. The battery is probably meant to go here, but it's probably going to rattle quite a lot in it. This goes probably here, here. Well, this board hits the display. You have to be kidding me, guys. This cover is going to hit the display connection. That's weird. Maybe I'm just doing it wrong, but anyway, it seems it has some design flaws. Not sure this hole has to be here or here. This one will have to be omitted, probably. And it goes this way. Well, this lever is hitting the housing as well, and the top cover will have to go probably here, instead of here as originally intended. Let's put it here. This is how it ends up. Now we have to glue it in place. I can't believe I'm actually recording this and including it in the video, and maybe I do it completely wrong. Is there a design flaw in the box, or did I just get it wrong? But this bit cannot fit into its intended position because of the display connection. Not sure how the battery is supposed not to rattle without sticking some random objects into it. Does it fit together? A little bit of this has to be cut out for the lever. The screws are probably way too long. Not sure if they go in like this or like this. Now of course the hole doesn't really align with the button. And this definitely doesn't look right. Let's botch it. Now it somehow fits. So the box is finished and it works, and the current gain reading is very similar for normal bipolar transistors. But for Darlington transistor, the gain reading seems to be quite different. This one says 189,000, this one 116,000. And let's try the DS18B20 temperature sensor in this one, and it seems to operate. It shows the pin configuration, the temperature reading, which is probably right, and whatever that is, heating it with my fingers, it seems to work. Of course the other one can't communicate with this. So that's this digital temperature sensor. Testing a high capacitance capacitor in this one, and it seems to be close. This is what a multimeter says. And this one is actually closer to the multimeter reading. And a high resistance, 6.8 megaohms nominal. And this one, and the multimeter reading. This one is definitely closer to the multimeter reading than this one. This one seems more accurate for resistors and capacitors than this one. And putting the same tiny MOSFET into both. This one doesn't measure the on-state resistance like this one does. And this one also doesn't measure the voltage drop of the internal diode. This one measures it here. So yes, this one definitely gives you more readings. And a very small thyristor. Let's test it using my very old component tester. Let's connect it like this. The positive to the anode, the negative to the cathode, and let's give the gate a pulse. It turns on and it stays on until the anode current is interrupted. So this thyristor is good. This thing doesn't test it. It tests the diode. And this one can't test it either. So as you can see, sometimes a very simple tester works better. This is just a battery, some LEDs with series resistors, and a base connection with some series resistor. And one of the LEDs has an amplifying transistor in it to amplify the current to see a small leakage. So that's it. These things can measure quite a lot of components, but you can still occasionally bump into a component which they can't test. So that's it, and please consider supporting my channel on Patreon. And a big thanks to all of you who already support me. And the next time, probably analyzing and maybe fixing the failure of this charger.